So we've talked about now the amount of distance that an aircraft requires on the ground for landing and for takeoff. And that distance is called the ground roll. But in reality, the runway length required for an aircraft is longer than the ground roll. I mean, you can imagine that if the runway length was exactly the length of the ground roll, the aircraft would be taking off right at the very end of the runway. And that's something that we don't really want. So in order to deal with this, there's a Federal Air Regulation, or FAR, standard that requires that an aircraft reach a certain height, obstacle clearance height, when it reaches the end of the runway. So the way that this looks is something like this. I'm going to attempt to draw it. Okay, so if this is our runway, shown here in white, and you know, you can imagine this is solid ground. Forgive my crooked lines there. Okay, so if our aircraft is sitting on the runway, at a stop. So this is V equals zero. And then it starts to accelerate. And it moves down the runway. It reaches liftoff speed, at which point it rotates in preparation for liftoff. And then it lifts off. So it's still at liftoff speed, and then it takes off right at this point. Now, at this point, the aircraft's going to enter an accelerated climb. So it's going to start to climb. And let's see if we can draw it up here. Sorry, my aircraft does not look that great today. Okay, so now it's climbing. So the height that it has to be at the end of the runway, as I just said, is the obstacle clearance height, which we're going to call H sub OC. Okay? And this is dictated by FAR regulations. And by FAR regulations, your obstacle clearance height has to be usually around, usually around 35 feet for commercial aircraft. But for general aviation aircraft, it's usually around 50 feet. Okay, so let's recap here. We have an acceleration phase, S sub A, which goes from stop to the liftoff speed, at which point we go into a rotation phase, which goes however long it takes for the aircraft to rotate and build up enough lift to take off. And then there's this new phase here, which we'll call SC. And the total length here is S sub OC, which is the FAR takeoff distance. So really, if we want to figure out how long the runway needs to be, we've got to include the time it takes for the aircraft to reach obstacle clearance height. Just a couple notes here. By FAR regulations, the liftoff speed has to be 1.1 times the stall speed. And actually, the obstacle clearance speed, so the speed at which the aircraft reaches the obstacle clearance height, has to be 1.2 times the stall speed. Okay, so this indicates that between liftoff and the obstacle clearance height, the aircraft has to accelerate. So that's why we are in accelerated climb. Okay, and during this time, our climb angle is changing as a function of time. Our velocity is also changing as a function of time. Okay, so So this is just the basis here of what we need to consider. However, this is a best case scenario for an aircraft. Let's talk a little bit about what happens then if we have engine failure. So I'm going to change colors here to discuss engine failure. So let's consider an aircraft with two engines, like your typical commercial airliner, and it's sitting on a runway. So let me draw this real quick. Okay, so here's our runway. And now I'm going to draw our aircraft in blue. Okay, so... wow, let me restart here. Restart this aircraft. I don't know why it's so hard for me to draw these flat. Oh boy, I have an idea. Because I'm very practiced at drawing things at an angle, apparently. Okay, so here's our aircraft. Let me put it on the ground now. Alrighty, there it is. Sitting on the ground with some wheels. Alright, so the aircraft, let's say the aircraft accelerates. Okay, and it gets to a point, which we're going to mark here in yellow, where one of the engines fails. Okay, so we have one engine fail. Okay, so now at this point, the aircraft has gained some speed. It's gone from stop to some velocity here. And at this point, it starts to brake and it slows down, but there's a certain distance required for it to brake, which we'll call the braking distance. Now, alternatively, the aircraft could continue to accelerate and try and take off. But with one engine, it would take longer for the aircraft to accelerate than it normally would with two engines. So it's going to require more runway. And if it did that, you know, let's say the engine fails fairly early on and the pilot decides to still take off, there's going to be a certain distance required to take off and reach obstacle clearance height. So the aircraft moves along and reaches obstacle clearance height here. Okay? And so this would be the obstacle clearance distance required. Now, let's consider the case maybe where the engine fails a little bit later on. So let me draw another airstrip here. This one, let's do it in white just to be consistent. All right, and let's grab our airplane and copy it. There it is. Okay, so now it's moving along. And now, so it starts from stop, moves, and now we're going to say that the engine fails maybe at this point here. So it's much further along its acceleration phase. And boom, one engine fails. So now the pilot can try and brake. And from this point to where it needs to brake is going to be longer than it was before, because now it's sped up. So this distance here, the braking distance, or alternatively, the pilot could choose to take off, and that's going to require a certain distance, but now since we're at a higher velocity, it won't take as long as it did before, and in fact, it may be something that can be done faster than it would take to brake before the end of the runway, or in less distance than it would take to brake before the end of the runway. And so now the obstacle clearance distance here from the point of engine failure is lower than the braking distance. So there's this trade-off that happens, and it depends on when the engine fails that it's going to be best to either take off or to brake. And the longest distance possible, because of this trade-off, is actually going to be the point where it's an equal distance to take off and reach obstacle clearance height as it is to break. So let's draw this last scenario here just for utter clarity. We have aircraft, it accelerates, and now we're going to have engines fail at some intermediate location. It's like, say, here. So we have engine failure. And now the distance required to take off and reach obstacle clearance height. I should make this so that they're at least somewhat comparable here. So the distance required to accelerate to obstacle clearance height, take off and get to obstacle clearance height, and the distance to brake are the same. So this distance here is going to be SB and SOC. So this total distance then, let me scroll down just a little bit. So now there's this total distance that's going to go from the point of initial, the point where the aircraft begins to the point where it can accelerate and lift off with one engine failing at some point in the middle. And the liftoff distance from the point of engine failure is equal to the braking distance from the point of engine failure. So if all those things are satisfied, we have this new distance that's going to be called the balanced field length. Okay? So the balanced field length is the distance required for the aircraft to accelerate to the engine failure velocity and then continue into obstacle clearance height. That is HOC. Or to accelerate to obstacle clearance velocity. Now the engine failure velocity is the point at which is the velocity at which, if the engine fails, the braking distance and the obstacle clearance distance from the point of engine failure are the same. So that's just a little bit of an overview of what balanced field length is. And in the next video, we're going to be talking about how to calculate the distance traveled in accelerated climb. But there's a couple, just two things to note before we finish. When calculating the balanced field length, we have to consider two things. One, there's a reaction time from the point of engine failure to when the pilot recognizes the engine has failed. And then there's reaction time also required for the pilot to either apply the brakes or continue into climb. So that has to be taken into account in the balanced field length. The other thing is that balanced field length is calculated without considering reverse thrust. Even if an aircraft has reverse thrust capabilities, by FAR regulations, that cannot be taken into account when calculating the balanced field length. So that's an overview of the balanced field length. We'll talk more about this in the next video.